The NIV, Hebrews 1:14. It says, "Are not all angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who will inherit salvation?" Let me read that again to you. "Are not all angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who will inherit salvation?" Is there anybody here tonight that's planning to inherit salvation? I mean, we've made that confession. We've accepted him, and we're saved by faith, but we'll experience that true salvation the day that we either die or we are translated in the spirit, you know, when Jesus calls us home. And so those who are destined to be a part of that, God has given us ministering spirits, angels, to guard over us, to watch over us, to serve us, to take care of us. And so it is scriptural. Let me just say this, though. We never want to worship an angel. An angel is not to be worshiped. An angel is there just to serve, just as you and I are here to serve. Okay? And we only worship the Lord God Almighty, amen, and of course, the Son and the Holy Spirit, the triune God. But that's who we worship, not angels. But Liz had an experience. So, Liz, will you come and just share a few minutes? So I want you to open your heart. She's going to take a few minutes before I get into Corinthians chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Would you like me to get you a microphone, or are you?
I think maybe my voice is loud.
Okay.
Florida, and can you hear me now? I don't know if I can hold this or not, Pastor.
You want me standing and hold it for you?
No. I'll try.
Okay.
Anyway, I was 6 years old, and the 301 ran right through our little town. And my grandmother and grandfather, they had a little house on the other side of 301, and because my grandfather was a guard for Pasco Packing Company. Well, I used to ride my little bike up there and then walk across 301. We didn't have a light or anything, but I had went and visited them, and on my way back, I got my bike up to my front wheel was touching the highway. And I saw my mother and father on the other side. And he was going like that. Well, I thought, oh, Lord, I got to get home. But what he was doing, he was telling me, look out for the car. And like I say, my bike wheel touched the line of the highway. And I was paying more attention to him than I was the car. But just as I started, something grabbed me by my shoulder. And I stopped. And that instant, that car went by. It was doing about 30 or 40 miles an hour. So I looked back, but there was no one there. And I was 6 years old, but so I was saved then. Okay. Let's see. When we moved out of that place, out in the country, my dad used to take us to Lake Iola a lot. And it's in San Antonio, where the big college is out there. And it had a big, long dock that went out in the water. So Miss Liz here decided to run and jump off the end of that dock and do a cannonball. Well, I did, but I landed a little bit farther out than I thought. All I could do was dog paddle, but I hit the bottom so I could... The lake was clear enough, I could see the ladder at the bottom of the dock. So here I go, and I was trying to hold my breath, and I thought I'd never get to that ladder. Finally, I got to the ladder, and I said, Lord, I know I'm going to drown right here. But all of a sudden, my foot stepped on something round, and I thought, and whatever what it was, it shot me up that ladder. And I got up on the dock, and I sat there trying to catch my breath. And I could see the sides of each on each side of the dock. And I kept looking to see, because I wanted to apologize for I thought I stepped on somebody's head. But I sat there. Nobody came out on the sides. And I sat there, and I looked down. No one ever came up. No one. So I got saved again. Praise the Lord. Now, we used to go down to Fort Meade in the summertime. And going into Fort Meade, there was a big, deep phosphate pit full of dark, dark green water. And then they had a little fence that divided the shallow from that dark green water. Well, Miss Liz, of course, decided to go up underneath the fence. And I did, and I got over there, and that water was so cold, and but I was holding on to the fence. So I thought, well, I'll just go back under it. Well, I got halfway underneath that fence, and something held me underneath the water. My bathing suit had got hung on that fence. Well, I was trying to go backwards, and I was trying to go forward, and I couldn't do it. And I thought, I just can't. I don't know if I can breathe anymore, you know. But all of a sudden, it's like something just pushed me underneath that fence. Well, it tore a big old hunk out. I tell you how young I was. It was an old wool bathing suit, you know. So it tore a big hunk out, but praise the Lord, I didn't drown. Okay, when I was about 13 years old, my cousin Frances, she wanted me to go riding with her and her boyfriend. I said, well, okay. My aunt said, well, she can't go unless you go with her. So I said, okay. So he took us up towards Brooksville, and it was about 9 or 9:30 at night. Okay. About when he turned around to come back, he said, Liz, how about you driving? I don't know how to drive. He said, I'll get it going, and you just, you know, I think it must have been automatic, because, you know. Anyway, I got in, and I thought, I can't drive. But I kept trying to keep that car in the road, and there was not a whole lot of traffic that night, praise the Lord. But while I was riding down that road, this car came around, and it was a boy that I had seen in Dade City. So I thought, I blinked my light 3 or 4 times, but he didn't slow up. So I thought, I'll just catch him. You know, so I was going about 60 miles an hour, not being able to drive now, and I didn't think anything about it. I wasn't scared of nothing until I got home to her house. Then I got to thinking, if I had lost control of that car, or if I'd have had a blowout, I would have probably killed us all three. But who was in the seat beside of me? My angel. Okay. Now, we moved to Newport Richey, and I always went home on the weekend because Richard opened a Badcock store up in Newport Richey. So I always went home, and so one day we had an old Nash Rambler. It wasn't a station wagon, it was just an old car. Well, coming out of Newport Richey, there's a little bridge, like. And if you've ever been over there, the traffic, it was 2-lane then. It's not like it is now. The traffic never stopped. When you got off the road, you just could not hardly get back on the road. Okay, when I was coming up over that little bridge, all of a sudden, my car went over to the other lane. And then back across. And when I got stopped, I was just a little ways from a big telephone or a light pole. Well, I sat there. I was so nervous I couldn't breathe. So I got up, and I went around the car. And what happened, my sway bar broke. You men probably know what a sway bar is. What happened when I went around, my car, body of my car was over here, and the back tire and rod looking thing was out here, you know. And then I went around and I looked at that telephone post, and Pastor, I stopped. I didn't stop, but that car stopped within so many inches of that post. Now, I had Cindy and Ricky. They were the only ones I had at that time. But I got to thinking, Lord, I know that my angel was with me, because there was such a little space right there in that traffic. So much traffic, you just can't imagine. But when I went across and back across, it was like the cars just slowed up. So that was a miracle right there. Okay, now, in 1972, we moved to Lakeland, and I worked at the school. I retired from the school board, and I worked with the PE. Now, that day, we had gotten all the kids. It was in the afternoon. We had gotten all the kids back into class except the TMR class. That's the trainable children. So my other worker, she had to go up to the office. So I was standing there with those children, and I heard this noise, and I couldn't, what in the world is that? And I happened to look, and here come this big black cloud or something of something. But then I said, I know what that is, because Lakeland had a lot of orange trees back then. So I knew it was a big swarm of bees. So I said, kids, I said, hey, let's go behind the PE building. So I finally got them not behind, but the side of the building. And just as we stepped off of the hardtop, that swarm of bees, if you've ever seen a swarm of bees, they travel fast. And they came right across to where those kids had been sitting. And if I hadn't tried to get them up and my angel hadn't slowed them bees down, they would have covered all them little kids and probably killed them. But praise the Lord. Okay, now Pastor was talking also about how God used the Holy Spirit. I've just got one other thing, Pastor, okay? Everybody knows practically that I lost both of my boys, but this is about my oldest son when we lived in Lakeland. He passed away down there. And one night as we were sitting there, the phone rang, and Richard said, yes, sir, it is. And then he didn't say anything else. And I kept looking at him. He had the funniest look on his face. And then when he hung up, I said, what's the matter? He said, I just had a call from an executive of Walt Disney World. He told me, I had my prayer time, and the Holy Spirit told me to call this family in Lakeland. And he says, I don't know you, and I certainly didn't know Ricky. He said, to tell you all that your son Ricky is walking in the garden with Jesus. And I thought, how a grieving mother and a grieving daddy, what a message that was to us, you know. And so there's angels and there's a heaven and all. And I thank you, Pastor, for letting me share that.
Amen. Bless you, Liz. Thank you. How many of you are thankful that God has angels watching over you? You just never know, and we thank God for his protection and watching over us. And many times there are those of us that we realize it had not been for the hand of the Lord, you know, we could have really had problems. Well, tonight we're going to continue on in our study in the book of 1 Corinthians. For those of you that haven't been here before or haven't been here in a while, Paul was writing this letter from the city of Ephesus to the church at Corinth. Corinth was a church that Paul had established, and the church was in the midst of a community, and the whole city of Corinth was evil, wicked place. You know, we've talked about how evil it was. I've talked to you about how, you know, the carnal lifestyle that was there, and the sexual pleasures that were being played out. People have been divorced and remarried multiple times. Almost sounds like today, you know, just terrible things that we hear, and just perverse things. And tonight, as we pick up, Paul has begun to address some of the problems that were going on in the church itself, because the church had allowed worldly views to come in instead of holding to the doctrine that he had taught them and holding to the words of Christ. They had begun to listen to others' opinions rather than to the word of Jesus. And so there were problems. Well, tonight we're looking at a situation that had happened in a church, and Paul found out about it through one of these letters that came to him. And this particular situation was a very unusual thing, but it could certainly happen in any church today, even so. And so if you will, draw your attention to verse 1. It says, "It is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and of a kind that does not occur even among pagans." I mean, he's talking about this. He says, this is very unusual. Why does this thing happen, and why are you allowing it to happen? He says, "For a man has his father's wife." Now, how many of you understand a father's wife? He's not talking about his mama, but he's talking about a stepmama. Daddy has remarried, and he's got another wife, and now the son is involved sexually with his dad's wife. This was a horrendous thing that could ever take place. It defiled the home. It defiled the father, defiled the mother, and it should have never taken place. Matter of fact, let me just tell you what the scripture tells us in the Old Testament about this. And in Leviticus chapter 18 and verse 6, this is one of the things that Moses had received from the Lord. It says, "No one is to approach any close relative to have sexual relations, for I am the Lord." And he says in verse 7, "Do not dishonor your father by having sexual relationships with your mother. She is your mother. Do not have relationships with her." In verse 8, it says, "Do not have sexual relations with your father's wife. That would dishonor your father." I mean, it was written. There were clear laws about how this should never happen. In Deuteronomy chapter 22 and verse 30, we read in another place here in the law, it says, "A man is not to marry his father's wife. He must not dishonor his father's bed." And one more in chapter 27 of Deuteronomy. In chapter 27 and verse 20, he says, "Cursed is the man who sleeps with his father's wife, for he dishonors his father's bed." I'm going to stop right there for just a minute, and let's pray. Lord, tonight, as we're dealing with a very detestable sin, a thing that should never have happened, God, I pray that you will give us ears to hear, and Lord, just the wisdom to comprehend what you are telling us tonight through Paul's writing. God, and how we should address situations that should ever occur in our own local church. Lord, for wisdom and counsel, Lord, we trust you will teach us and train us, Lord, that we will be the men and women of God that you want us to be. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Well, Paul continues on after he says this should not be type of a thing. This doesn't even happen among the pagans. I'm talking about in the world, but you're letting it go on in the church. And you know, look at verse 2. He says, "And you are proud." He says, you're proud of it. You're okay with it. You're puffed up, if you will. "Shouldn't you rather have been filled with grief and put them out of your own fellowship, the man who did this?" You know, Paul is looking at this, and he's saying, you know, some of you guys are thankful for grace, but you're taking advantage of grace. Let me talk about that. We sang about God's amazing grace a minute, and Paul is saying, some of you are saying, well, we're saved by grace. We can do whatever we want to. God's going to forgive us. We can do what we want to. You know, there are some people that believe that, and I'm here to tell you that is not the truth. That is not the truth. That is a lie from the pit of hell. You cannot live like you want to and still make it into the kingdom of God. If you love Jesus, you will surrender your heart to him, and you will commit your life to him and your ways to him, and he will forgive you of the past. And if you make a mistake and you sin by accident or unintentionally, you can ask God to forgive you. He will forgive you, but God will not allow you to serve him and serve your flesh at the same time. It's not going to happen. You can't serve two masters. Are you hearing what I'm saying tonight? Either you're for him or you're against him. We're going to live for him in this church. Can I hear it? Amen. You know, our desire is to please the Lord. We're not here to please our flesh. We're not here, you know, and we're talking about something very repulsive here in a situation where a man takes his father's wife, but there are other things just as bad. I mean, let's face it, when sin is sin, I mean, whether you're a thief or you're an adulterer, it doesn't matter. Sin is sin. Can I hear it? Amen. You know, there are no degrees of this thing. We're looking at, hey, you know, well, it's not that bad, people saying that. You know, I had somebody tell me the other day, he says, well, you know, I believe that I can kind of do whatever I want to and God's going to forgive me. Well, that's an intentional sin. That means that you don't believe in God's grace. You're taking advantage of God's grace, and you're, you know, God's not, he is not going to be happy with that whatsoever. I've got scripture after scripture that I can give you over that, but Paul said it this way in Romans chapter 6 and verse 1. He says, what shall we say? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? People talk about how good grace is. Well, if I keep sinning, God's grace keeps shining. Forget it. God forbid. That's not what he wants. Thank God for what he's done for you, and God has given us the ability to be transformed and changed into his likeness. God wants us to become more like him. Amen. We are being changed day by day. Verse 3 in our text says this, even though I'm not physically present, talking about Paul being over in Ephesus, he said, I'm not there with you right now. I'm writing this letter. I'm not there with you physically, but I'm with you in spirit. He says, and I have already passed judgment on the one who is doing this or who did this, just as if I was present. They were wrong. And he's already passing judgment. He said, I'm not there, but I mean, when he heard this, I believe Paul's blood began to boil. I believe Paul got very upset and said, how can this kind of thing go on in the house of God and nobody put a stop to it? We've got to be Christians. We've got to be men and women of God, and we can't live like the world. God didn't call us to be worldly. He called us to be godly. Amen. He redeemed us through his blood so that we would be righteous. Well, in verse 3, he goes on to say, I have already passed judgment on the one who did this, just as if I was present. He says, for when you are assembled in the name of the Lord Jesus, I'm with you in spirit, and the power of the Lord Jesus is present. How many of you know when two or three are gathered in his name, he's there in the midst of you? Amen. He says, when you're together, my spirit's with you. I'm in agreement with you. We need to deal with this thing. And so he goes on to say here, in verse 5, hand this man over to Satan so that the sinful nature may be destroyed and his spirit saved on the day of the Lord. Now, I want us to look at verse 5 for a minute. Verse 5 says, hand him over to Satan. This guy thinks he can come in and have fellowship with the church and still live like the devil. You know what? There are a lot of people that like to do that. A lot of people like to come in and they like to mingle with the saints of God. They like to rub shoulders with them. They like to feel like they're a part of what God's doing. But church, we have to take a stand. They cannot come in and say, hey, look, I'm just as good as you. You know, but yet they're living in sin. God doesn't want that to happen. He said, look, kick him out of the church. He said, well, that's wrong. Don't kick him out of church. How's he going to get saved? Bible says go to a person and warn them once. Warn them a second time. If they don't, then put them before the whole church. Come on. It's important that you not allow sin. How many of you know that Israel, when they went across the Jordan River and they fought Jericho, there was one man who took something that didn't belong to him. His name was Achan. And because of the sin that he had done, it caused the whole tribe of Israel to have pain and suffering. They lost the next battle, and they were going to continue to lose the battle until they got rid of the sin in the camp. Church, I want you to understand, we can't allow sin to remain in the church. We have to remove it. He says, hand him over to Satan. Well, the whole purpose of what Paul is saying here is, when you kick him out, hopefully he is going to feel ashamed. Hopefully he is going to say, hey, I miss the fellowship with those people. I really like them. And because of my lifestyle, I can't have fellowship. They won't let me back into the church. They won't let me be a part of what God is doing. And so they will ask for forgiveness. They'll repent of their ways and get their heart right, and they'll come back in. That's one scenario that we'd like to see happen. But he also says this in this verse. He says, hand this man over to Satan so that, and I always like to circle those two words or underline them, so that. Why? So that the sinful nature may be destroyed and his spirit saved on the day of the Lord. How many of you know when Jesus comes, there will be a judgment? Hopefully this man's heart will be changed before then. And, you know, I would rather somebody be upset and mad at me and get over, you know, the sin that they're having in their life than I had them to go to hell because we didn't warn them, because we didn't tell them. We didn't tell them what you're doing is wrong. You know, I've shared this story before. I've never revealed the name, and I won't. But there was a man who was involved in an illicit relationship coming to our church years ago. And I went to him and I said, look, you know, I know you want to join the church. I know you want to be a part of what God's doing here. And I said, we're going to give you a chance. Get your life in order. Put your house in order. Get things straightened out. And we'd love to have you stay here. He wanted to be there. Time rocked on, and he never would deal with it. It got pretty ugly one day, and he showed up at my office door. Police were not far behind him. And things were going on because of illicit things going on. He was not married to a woman. He had gotten her pregnant. He was living with her and still trying to live in another life. And I said, look, God is not going to honor that. I said, we've warned you. I said, if you can't change, then it's time for you to leave. Well, he went around and started talking to other people in the church, said, Pastor's kicking me out of the church. Pastor's kicking me out of the church. I went to my board and I said, yes, he's right. I'm kicking him out of the church. I've given him every opportunity to make the transition and the change. He doesn't want to change his lifestyle. He doesn't. How many of you know this is scripture, what we're talking about here? This is the word of God. It's better to tell him to go than it is to allow him to remain and cause sin to be in the camp. Amen? We can't allow that to happen. That man has had problems ever since. And he wound up going to jail. He wound up doing time. He got out. He called me, and I just said, has your life changed? Well, it changed while he was in jail, but it hadn't changed all the way. I'm telling you, you know, you've got to be sold out to Jesus. Amen? That's what it's all about. Anyhow, in verse 5, he said his sinful nature will be destroyed, but his spirit saved on the day of the Lord. Our hope is that they will be saved. We don't want anybody to die and go to hell. We want everybody to make it into heaven. Verse 6 goes on to say, your boasting is not good. You see, some of them boast about, well, you know, look at this, look at us, you know. And here's what he's saying. Do you not know that a little yeast works throughout the whole batch of dough? How many of you are familiar with using yeast? I don't remember too many people that use yeast in making bread anymore. Most of us, we go down to Sam's or Winn-Dixie, and we buy these yeast rolls that are already made up in the frozen part of the section there. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And we pull them out, we thaw them out, and we just stick them out there, and whew, we don't really get the yeast out and add it to the flour. How many of you do that a lot? You take the yeast and you make all that. A couple of you do. I'd like to come eat at your house sometime. But a little bit of yeast works through the whole batch of dough. And so If you remember when it was time for the Passover during the year, when they had the time of Passover, when they celebrated the Passover lamb, whenever Israel was released from Egypt. And God said, look, don't put any yeast into the dough during this time. This is a reminder of what God did for you. Okay? So you couldn't put any yeast, no yeast whatsoever. It was not supposed to be done. Well, he talks about yeast. Now, let me just say, yeast is often identified as evil or sin. How many of you know we don't need any evil or sin in our lives? Just a little bit of sin defiles the whole body. Just a little bit of yeast defiles the whole loaf. Okay, a little bit of yeast or sin defiles the man. When Paul says this to the church here, listen to what he's saying. Your boasting is not good. Don't you know that a little bit of yeast or a little bit of sin works through the whole batch of dough? Now, let me just give you a couple scriptures. Jesus said this in Matthew. In Matthew 16:6, he says, be careful, Jesus said to them. Be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. You know, sometimes they were twisting words and doing their little things. A little farther down in verse 12, he says this about them in chapter 16. He says, then they understood that he was not telling them to guard against the yeast itself, but the yeast, he says, used in bread, but against the teaching of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Sometimes they would stretch things or do things that were improper. Pharisees and the Sadducees had religious spirits. They had a form of godliness. They would stand on the street corners and pray these eloquent prayers, yet they themselves had a double life. They would live one way in front of people, and on the side, they were twisting and doing things that were underneath, that were evil. And I'm not saying all of them, but there were many who did. And God said, that shouldn't be. Remember, yeast is often identified by evil and sin. Well, in verse 7, back in our text, Paul says this as we go on. Get rid of the old yeast. Get rid of that sin. Get rid of the old things in your life. And he says, get rid of that old yeast that you may be a new batch without yeast, that you may be a new person without sin. How many of you know that you're a new creation? If Christ Jesus lives in you, you are born again. You are a new creation. Come on. We've been changed, and God is transforming us into his image. So when we read this, get rid of the old yeast that you may be a new batch without yeast, as you really are. For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Do you remember why they offered up that lamb on the night of the Passover? Remember, the word was given to them, take a lamb, slaughter it, take the blood, dip the hyssop or the ragweed, whatever, and take it. Put it on the doorpost, and then put it over top of the door lintel there. And he says, and then when the angel comes by, because of the blood that has been applied, the death angel will come by. He will pass over you. How many of you know that when Jesus became our Passover lamb, he applied the blood to our lives so that we could be free from sin, so that we could have a new life? And so when we see this, and this is what Paul's trying to identify with them, he says, you know, for Christ is our Passover lamb and has been sacrificed. It's already been paid for. It's already been done. So get rid of the yeast, for Christ has already been that sacrifice. Let me just read to you out of Isaiah for a second. Isaiah 53 and verse 7 says this, he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter and as a sheep before the shearers and silent. So he did not open his mouth. How many of you know Jesus was our Passover lamb? He paid the price for you and me. Therefore, he says in verse 8 in our text, therefore, let us keep the festival, talking about the Passover. Let us keep this festival. Let us hold on to what God has given us, not with the old yeast, with sin or old traditions. He says, the yeast of malice and wickedness. But let us hold on to it with the bread without yeast, meaning the new life we have in Christ. Let us hold on to it, the bread of sincerity and in truth. Verse 9 goes on to say, I have written you in my letter not to associate with the sexually immoral people. Folks, how many of you know we're not to allow ourselves to associate with people in the church that are sexual impure? He's not talking about outside the church right now. How else are we going to win the lost? But he's talking about if somebody comes in here and you know they're not living the life that they should be living, we should separate ourselves from them. And they're going to say, well, what's wrong with me? And all you got to do is say, is Jesus really Lord of your life? Is he really in charge? Are you allowing yourself to follow the pleasures of the flesh or over Christ? How many of you understand? That's where we need to be. We need to be serving him. 2 Corinthians 6:14 says, do not be yoked together with unbelievers. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? You see, there are people that come into the church and claim to be something that they're not. They may have prayed a prayer of forgiveness, but there was never any repentance in their heart. They've never changed. They've not repented of their ways. It takes more than lip service. It takes a change from the heart. Can I hear an amen? You'll say, Pastor, this is awful hard stuff tonight. That's okay. It's true. It's important. Ephesians 5:11 says, have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. Church, we're to expose them. 2 Thessalonians 3:6 says this, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we command you, brothers, to keep away from every brother who is idle and does not live according to the teachings that you receive from us. If they're not obeying the truth, you shouldn't be having fellowship with them. This is what Paul was saying about this whole idea, was they're allowing this man to have fellowship in the church, and he's living in sin, and it shouldn't be. Now, when he says about not having fellowship, look at verse 10 real close. It says, not at all meaning the people of this world. That's what I talked about a minute ago. Not at all talking about the people of this world who are immoral or greedy or swindlers or idlers. For in that case, you would have to leave this world. How many of you know? I mean, we are amongst them all day long. But that's why we're the light. You see, hopefully we can touch their lives. But it's the ones who are playing church that we need to be careful about. He says in verse 11, but now I'm writing you that you must not associate with anyone who calls himself a brother but is sexually immoral or greedy. Uh-oh. We've done changed gears here. We're not just sexual immoral people. Sexual immoral, greedy, idolaters, slanderers. What is a slanderer? Somebody talking bad about somebody else. Watch your tongue, folks. Watch what you say. Let every word that proceeds out of your mouth be uplifting and encouraging, not tearing down. Can I hear an amen? That was kind of weak. Can I hear an amen? All right. A drunkard, a swindler, he says, with such a man, do not even eat. Paul was pretty serious about this. He said, don't have anything to do with these kind of people. They claim to be brothers, but they're not living the life. If they're not living the life, then we should not continue to associate with them until they have come to their senses and changed and repented of their ways and made their heart right before God. Matthew 18 says this in verse 15. He says, if your brother sins against you, He says, go and show him his fault just between the two of you. How many of you know that's the way we should deal with anybody that we see that does the same? Don't go talking about him to everybody else. If you see somebody mess up, don't go tell Kelvin and then go tell Skip or Lillis or this one or that one. No, 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 no. You go talk to them. That's what the scripture says. He says, if your brother sins against you, go and show his fault. Show him his fault just between the two of you. If he listens to you, you have won your brother over. Now, we know a lot of times they don't like to listen. But he says, if he will not listen, take one or two others along with you so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, treat him as you would a pagan or a tax collector. Anybody in here love the IRS? No. Paul finishes out this teaching tonight by saying this in verse 12. What business is it of mine to judge those who are outside the church? You don't have, it's not your job to judge these people over here across the street, the one down the road there, the one over here, the one that lives back here, the one that lives next door to your house. If they're not Christians, it's not your job to judge them. They're going to face judgment. It's not your job is to tell them about Jesus. Amen? But it's not your job to judge those that are outside the church. He says, are you not to judge those inside? You know, I've heard a lot of people about say this. Well, we're not supposed to judge the church. We're not supposed to judge each other. Whoa, 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 whoa. Here you go. Listen. I want you to get this. Underline it. It's in your Bible. Are you not to judge those inside? Paul's saying. Verse 13, for God will judge those outside. Expel the wicked man from among you. How many of you know Paul is telling us that we should be judging our brothers? It's our responsibility to be accountable one to another. Somebody said, well, Pastor, that's not the way I understood it. Then you were told wrong. What can I say? You're not supposed to be judging. No, I'm not supposed to judge the world. If you claim to be a Christian, then you better live like it. Anybody with me? If you ain't, then you aren't reading the truth. How many of you believe this is the word of God? Amen. The Bible says the truth will what? Set you free. Most of us would rather run and tell somebody else about a brother's fault rather than going to the brother and telling him, look, you know, I'm worried about you. It's between me and you. I'm concerned. Can you get things in order in your life? Can I pray with you about something? Can I do this for you? Can I, any way I can help you? Let me tell you what. If you can do that, you'll win a brother. You'll win him. Because you probably aren't the only one that has seen what's going on. But when you go around and you start running your mouth to other people, you've lost your opportunity to win that brother. And you've caused dissension. Division. Go to that one first. Deal with them. If they don't listen, take a couple others with you. Go talk to them. Maybe they'll come to their senses. If not, then you have to do the ultimate and tell the church. Let me tell you what, if we'll all examine our own hearts, we won't have to worry about somebody coming to us and telling us, hey, I've been noticing this in your life. How many of you know we talk about everybody else's problem and we don't even see the big plank in our own eye? We got a splinter in somebody else's eye, but we got this big 4x4 going in ours. And you know, if we'll examine ourselves and we'll keep ourselves in check, God will be honored. Amen? Amen. I pray that we never have to do what the church at Corinth had to do. Pray that we don't have to go to somebody and say, look here, I'm sorry. But you're going to have to leave this fellowship until you get your life in order. You know, oftentimes I'd like to give them the opportunity to change before they go. If they don't change, then you'll have to go. Where else can you get the help but with the Lord? Hopefully the church will love you. How many of you know the church loves you? Do you love your brothers and sisters in the Lord? Amen. I do.